My topic today is the evitability of war. But before I get into that, I just want to share a couple of things about my discipline and how I got interested in this topic. You see here Raphael's School of Athens, icon of the Italian Renaissance. And I love this painting. And of course, there's many things one can say about this painting, but for what it symbolizes about my discipline, you see a wide array of historical figures from philosophy engaged in conversation. And if you look at the middle there, you see two of the most recognizable figures, Plato and his student Aristotle, engaged in what is clearly symbolic of a disagreement between teacher and student. And this tells us some important things about my discipline of philosophy. First of all, it's a conversation. Philosophy, the history of philosophy is a conversation across time and space. It's a conversation that is engaged in rational dialogue, and perhaps even more important, when people give reasons for the things they believe, they're open to scrutiny. Anybody who cares can come and take a jab at your idea. And that's wonderful because it means that philosophy is inherently subversive. This is what drew me to philosophy. It's a rebellious sort of discipline. You see here that the student has no compunction about questioning his teacher. This hasn't always worked out so great for philosophers. Your corruptors of the youth, atheists, or otherwise undermining social norms. And I don't want to give the impression that philosophers routinely are dragged out and pilloried. But at the same time, doing philosophy and engaging in your society in a meaningful way usually involves a certain level of discomfort. When you question the conventional wisdoms of your society, people are likely to lash out or fight back in various ways. My small example of this that I want to share with you is when I started meeting with a group of colleagues here at the JSC with a goal to develop a major in the study of peace and nonviolence. It seemed to us at the time, and it still seems to me today, that there is a real gap in the curriculum. Whereas there's ample opportunities to study war and violence, there are very, very sparse opportunities across the academy, with the exception of a few Quaker and Mennonite universities, to really, for undergraduates to learn about this rich tradition. So I decided to mitigate this in some small way by starting a course of my own in the philosophy of peace and nonviolent action. I delved into the material, I read the usual suspects from the great abolitionists, Lucretia Mott, all the way through, Dr. King and Gandhi and other folks. Of course, I studied some of the great nonviolent movements, labor and independence and so forth. And of course, I studied a bit of war. But what I also did was I wandered around, I talked to anybody who would talk to me about this project. I was really excited about it. The literature is so vast and rich. What I thought was just a pool of interesting topics turned out to be an ocean, and I dove into it with just great joy. But it turns out when I talked to people, I was met mostly with polite indifference. As I spoke to colleagues, many were very supportive, and I thank them all, they know who they are. But a lot of them were a little bit suspicious that perhaps I was going to introduce students to some kind of utopian dream of sorts. And that was the polite, and just one example, I was sitting around the poker table with some friends, and I mentioned this project of mine, and my friend, a very educated a lawyer friend of mine, said, "Ah, philosophy of peace, shortest academic course ever." And like everybody laughed, and this was kind of routine in my experience. And so I wasn't surprised when I came across an article in the Chronicle of Higher Education by John Horgan. He's a science journalist who teaches about these topics. And he expressed his profound dismay over what he saw to be a growing trend among students of fatalistic attitudes towards war, this belief that somehow human nature is such that war is the inevitable outcome of our nature. And he, as he wrote in that article, many students expressed their views something quite similar to this film. Robert McNamara, you might know him, who was the Secretary of Defense of the JFK and LBJ. He tells us that, of course, we're not going to change human nature anytime soon, implying that war will be a necessary and permanent aspect of our lives. And I found this over and over again was repeated by students. And what's more, students started to express this view as if it had some kind of legitimate scientific basis, that this is the consensus in the realist realm where science has been. So I thought, well, maybe I better look into this a bit. Why did I think this was a problem? Well, first of all, I think this is the kind of belief that perhaps is self-fulfilling. The more likely you think war is inevitable, the less likely you're going to try to do anything about it. Of course, it's ideological, which means it's a kind of belief system where conclusions drive evidence, right? It's not the way science is supposed to work. Is you build evidence, you draw conclusions, or you just confirm hypotheses when the evidence doesn't share your view. But in this case, people were convinced of the view and they were selective about the evidence they chose to look at in order to reinforce their existing view. It also leads to a certain myopia. When people are convinced something is inevitable, I noticed this over and over again in my conversations, they just couldn't see the problem. The victims of war and the destruction of war just weren't present to them. They didn't notice it anymore. Which is kind of ironic given the pervasiveness in our media. And of course this suppresses innovation. Who's likely going to develop new ideas, how to address these problems? And this has, you know, disastrous results for public policy, how funds and research are addressed. Anyway, I thought I should stick to my comfort zone. I'm going to look into the history of philosophy and see what my colleagues across the ages have to say about this matter. And so I started reading some of the old folks that I were familiar with, and everyone from Plato and Cicero in the ancient world through the great contract theorists of the Enlightenment period had an idea about human nature, and they justified, they built their system of government on this idea that human nature was such, and we can legitimate government on the basis of that. By far, I found the most common conception of human nature, the most influential one, is this fellow, Mr. Hobbes. If you don't know about Hobbes, my guess is that you are familiar with his view in one way or another. His influence has been incredibly pervasive across all kinds of life. He begins, you know, he was a big fan of Galileo, and he thought human beings are part of nature. And like all things in nature, we heard about this today, things stay in motion unless met with some opposite force. Mm-hmm. And he thought we were no different. We are machines that are desiring machines. This is what keeps us moving forward. Because we have desire, we seek power to satisfy this desire. That's a big part of what drives us in life. He also was one of the first egalitarians. He thought people were essentially equal in their ability to kill each other. You know, so you see a very grim picture is unfolding here. People compete for scarce resources, a pretty common assumption. People who have stuff are going to be worried about someone to take their stuff away. And then people who don't have stuff are going to be worried that the people that have stuff are going to attack them for fear that they're going to take their stuff away. And then some people are going to try to get reputations by taking out other people who have reputations and so on and so forth. And his result was, well, life in the state of nature is solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short. Well, he thought there was a solution. He thought people, once they understood this logic of anarchy, they would willingly give up their liberty of nature for a strong state. In other words, security trumps liberty in Hobbes' view. Well, this view hasn't gone away. In fact, by other means. And Mr. Kissinger is actually the first one to introduce the idea of realpolitik, or what's kind of called political realism in our society. And it definitely is in operation today. I pulled this exact quote from two separate speeches of Bush and Obama speaking about the Iranian nuclear program. So I delved into the relevant fields. I thought, you know, what do the people who know about human nature or study human nature say about this stuff? So I began with the anthropologist, and of course this is a gross oversimplification, but you see her village dry. He's studied a lot of societies. He's planned to identify 74 non-warring societies. And then you see Spiegel LeBlanc on the right, who accuses folks like Fry of inventing fairy tales about prehistory human beings. He claims that war was much more pervasive in the olden days. Then the primatologist, again, you know, the similar disputes pervade that field. Let's look at Richard Raymond first, his influential book, Demonic Males, where he investigated the fact that chimpanzees engage in organized warfare. And this led him to the conclusion that we're the dazed survivors of a 5 million year habit of lethal aggression. But when you compare them to folks like Sapolsky, a neurologist and primatologist at Stanford, he did very interesting studies in the field with savannah baboons and found that really cultural changes in groups of baboons can cause them to react very remarkably different than what they had been presumed to be kind of hardwired to do. When he saw males grooming each other, he said this was nearly as unprecedented as baboons sprouting wings, right? And of course, there's Duval, maybe the most interesting of them all, who has done a lot of interesting work with the bonobo. Like chimpanzees, we share a lot of genetic similarities with bonobo. And he has reported there's no deadly warfare, little hunting, no male dominance, and enormous amounts of sex. I've forgone the Isaac Hayes soundtrack I have for this later. Again, you see similar debates in sociobiology and evolutionary psychology and virtually every other field that addresses this. I don't want to give you the impression that there are no reasonable positions in these fields. In fact, quite the contrary. You find lots of agreement between these folks, even though they disagree widely about whether or not Hobbes is right or some nicer account of our nature is true. I'd like to focus just for a second on this fellow Steven Pinker. He's another TED speaker. I think Sapolsky was too. And he's recently written on the fractal decline of violence. He says, despite appearances, despite common belief, it's actually the case that violence is in radical decline. He's looked at the archaeological data, and a lot of evidence seems to show that we live in one of the most peaceful times on Earth. He says, well, what explains this attitude that violence is so pervasive? And he turns to the concept of a cognitive illusion. He thinks that, you know, our brains are so likely to recall events that we've seen recently or ones that are dramatic like violence that we have this false impression that it's much more pervasive. And of course, it's much less likely that the media is going to show somebody dying of old age than a bomb going off and stuff. So this reinforces the problem. So what explains this decline? How could it be that we have this aggressive nature, and nonetheless, things seem to be getting better? And one of the explanations he gives is, well, maybe Hobbes was right. Maybe modernity, these stronger states, greater international cooperation, things like the EU or treaties and so forth, are making a difference. And the establishment of universal rules of human rights and such are making a dent into this problem of war. So let's just review a couple of the commonalities. All those folks you saw on the screen, whether it's Raymond and his chimpanzees or Duval and his bonobos, they all believe that war can be reduced or possibly even eliminated if we reject fatalism in ourselves and in our leaders. If we strengthen bonds of interdependency, either through international ties or building communities, increase education opportunities for women. This is really important. Because when women are educated and they have economic opportunities, this helps enormously with the population growth. That puts huge strains on our resources. We need to develop, of course, new sustainable resources. A lot of folks have talked about this today. And finally, we need to confront the political exploitation of tribalism. When you look deeply into these events of tribal conflict, almost always in modern history, we find a political effort to stir these on. So, after I kind of dispensed with the scientific world, I thought, well, gosh, we have these experts out there in security. What did the military think about human nature? And is there any basis in this popular view about this? Here's Lieutenant Dave Grossman. He's written a work on killing. It's a required reading at law enforcement academies, elite military institutions, and a few peace programs around the world. What did he find? Well, he talks about the problem. The biggest problem militaries face is actually getting people to do something they're very reluctant to do, and that is kill other human beings. They have to use a lot of conditioning techniques, like reflexive fire training, ways of overcoming the prefrontal cortex, which is our the part of our brains that thinks about moral things prior to acting. Dehumanization of the enemy is still in full force. You need to make sure that people are comfortable with killing people, and one of the best ways of doing this is to alleviate them of the problem of actually killing people. You're the bad guys. We're not even bad at all. He also points to the psychiatric casualties. If we are naturally wired to kill, why is it that it causes so many problems among those who engage in killing? And so he raises some profound questions about this conventional wisdom. Of course, I have to look at what the nonviolentists say about this stuff, right? That's the point of my class. And I turned to Barbara Deming. She's one of my heroes. I'd never heard of her before I really started digging into this material. And she talks, in many ways, she reminds the nonviolent community that we need to really expand our conception of nonviolence. Stop talking about nonviolence being reduced to protest or moral pleading and such. Alleviate people of the illusion that there isn't a wide range of possibilities short of killing that we can engage in. We need to clarify the language. It's wonderful to love your neighbor. It's fabulous to forgive your enemies. But how do you convince somebody whose child has been tortured or whose husband has been murdered that they ought to love their enemy? She thinks we need to broaden the scope of these and talk more about the basic idea of not harming bodies. And she also talks about focus on the long term. What chances are there in violent engagements that you are going to win over that part of the population that loses? We need to build a society, and if you lose the war, the likelihood that you will contribute positively to that new society is radically decreased. There's lots of people doing work in this area. You may have heard of Gene Sharp, Peter Ackerman's wonderful book and accompanying video that details many of the most important instances of nonviolent revolution. Jonathan Glover is an important philosopher. I recommend him to you all. He's done a detailed assessment of the atrocities of the 20th century and talked about how those moral reserves, those natural inclinations that we have, sympathy, respect, and so forth, some of the things Mr. Serres talked about today, are broken down and chipped away by institutions and the progressive nature of war and violent policies. Of course, we need a lot more look at the video, at the world of media. Folks like Norman Solomon, who you met today, and Noam Chomsky, who clarify patterns of propaganda, who expose the media's failures and abuses, and train people to see these things for what they are. A recent book I can't recommend more, if nothing else for its ambition, is we need much more rigorous study, comparing the effectiveness of violent and nonviolent methods. And in this important work, Why Civil Resistance Works, they've done a rigorous attempt to really look at how these organizations or these methods function in the context of conflict and determine what is actually effective. And because the costs are severe, and I'm not going to read this whole thing, but I think in this time of budgetary crunches, you can appreciate that last line, the cost of one modern heavy bomber is this, a modern brick school in more than 30 cities. This is from the mouth of a lawyer. Because after all, think of what's possible.